A special thanks to Hannah Kassim and Dan for This Is Their Committee, Global Dialogues, which have taken it to a level beyond we ever imagined, and thank you for letting us continue Viral Voices 3. And for those that don't know this, this is the third year running. So 3 years ago, ArchDaily and Bjark Ingels launched an incredible lecture series called Viral Voices, and we talked about how we were blurring the lines across territories. Last year, Wiggly came in and brought academia to the front of the discussion. And this year, we're going to talk about globalization, the idea of new territories and new opportunities. So with that said, Sammy Medina, editor at Metropolis Magazine, is going to lead the evening. And thank you so much. I hope you guys enjoy tonight.
Hi, everyone. I haven't done this in a while, so bear with me if I stumble over my words. I'll make it as entertaining as possible. So thanks to everyone for showing up. I hear there's rain promise, so and for filling up the room. Thanks to Jeff from KPF for setting everything up and for organizing tonight's event and all of the various discussions that we're having. And also thanks to the New York chapter of the AIA for hosting us here at the Center for Architecture. So piggybacking on something that Jeff just touched upon, I think I was interested in kind of presenting tonight's discussion in the sense that trying to find out how viral voices has kind of changed and mutated in the last, this is only the third year, but it's also kind of significant in how many changes have occurred in that brief time span. The original outline is just from blurring lines, academia, and tonight will be globalization. Globalization is a much confusing but also complex topic. I think we'll touch upon it tonight from a practitioner's point of view, but also from kind of the internet's point of view, if that makes any sense at all. So we'll start off with two presentations, one from Greg Lindsay, who I'll introduce in a minute, and the other from the two Davids, the co-founders of ArchDaily. Following those two presentations, we'll go into a more or less lengthier panel with six or so panelists, and we'll be discussing, or we'll hash out all what these kind of topics mean and the various things that come up in the previous discussions. So to introduce, Greg Lindsay is a journalist, urbanist, and contributing writing at Fast Company. He's also the co-author of Aerotropolis, The Way We'll Live Next, the same book that he was recently interviewed by Hans-Ulrich Olbers at the Biennale. He's also written for various publications like the New York Times, The Guardian, and an incredible fun fact that I just remember, or just was brought attention to, he's a two-time Jeopardy champion, which is great. So join me in welcoming Greg tonight.
Thank you, Sammy. Thank you so much. Thank you all so much for coming. It certainly says something about the state of the design journalism field where one is forced to resort to game shows to make a living, but that is where I am. It certainly paid better than any work I've done. It's always an honor for me to be asked to speak to a group of architects and urbanists and designers and planners when I am neither an architect myself nor an architect educator. I always assume when I'm asked to speak in this role that you expect wisdom from the mouth of babes, and so I hope to have a little bit, that perhaps the fool will have an occasional thing of inspiration or two to give. So for my talk tonight, I don't want to talk that much about this notion of social media and or globalization. I want to talk, I guess, sort of a bit about a travelogue about the last 6 weeks, because it's been a particularly hectic time for me traveling and speaking, and I think it's very interesting and informative in the sense of I've had a chance to really rub up against all the various, I think, sort of forces that are sort of impinging upon the architecture as a profession and forcing it to rethink its role, in a sense. One of the themes I was thinking about in going through my slides and thinking about this is, and questions that I'm interested in is, how does the profession of architecture begin to rethink itself when it no longer is a position to build anything? What does it mean to be an architect who doesn't build? Because I think, as we'll get into, I think that's really sort of the greatest delusion of the profession in the sense of that it has to build something. And this is something that Frank Duffy and many others have talked about and we'll get into. But I guess sort of start of this, I mean, this sort of apropos beginning of this, that, you know, my travelogue begins several weeks ago, or 6 weeks ago, I should say, at the press preview of the 14th Venice Architecture Biennale. My first, which I think, from my understanding, makes it somewhat unusual that I'm sort of there for the Rem Koolhaas-inspired one, which was sort of, you know, depending on how you saw it, is either a refreshing blast of fresh air or a completely cynical exercise in which he attempted to negate the role of architect in favor of the sort of supply chain of those who were involved. And it was interesting for me, you know, as someone who writes about aviation, read from the bottom for the joke, by the way, as someone who writes about aviation and globalization, it was funny to me to, you know, be boarding the plane. I'd upgraded myself on the way there, and immediately upon entering the Delta Lounge at JFK, I was approached by Keller Easterling of Yale, who's written such a great book, Extra Statecraft, about the role of zones and free trade. And here we were in a non-place in the JFK airport, where I was suddenly running into the entire New York architectural establishment. And then once I got into the first class of the Delta flight nonstop to Venice Marco Polo, it was Bjarke slouched in the back, looking like he always does, like he's 22 and petulant. And directly ahead of me was Jamie von Klemper from KPF, who is, of course, the architect of record on Songdo, which is the city that opens my book, the city being built off the coast of South Korea that's the size of downtown Boston, another architect who I had not met, Bonnie Roche. And it occurred to me there, you could see at the top, that if this plane went down tonight, who would design the future skylines of Pudong and all these other instant cities that we were there? But we arrived without incident in Venice, and it was there, interestingly enough, my first day in Venice, before I even got a chance to get to the Giardini and really start seeing the Koolhaas exhibition, I received a call from a property developer in Manila, where I'd given a talk the month before. And this property developer, the KMC Group, they're affiliated with Savills, the giant UK property giant, they were looking for a master planner to design, master builder, to design a site of 844 hectares of reclaimed land on the Manila waterfront that would be sited next to this, which is the renderings of a proposed $10 billion four-runway airport built in reclaimed land in Manila Bay. And it's interesting, and it says a lot to me about the profession, that these renderings are completely artificial. The site, the airport has not been approved by the government, and AECOM, it turns out, is designing the airport right now. But we have these renderings here to denote that this is a real project and it's really happening. And what I thought was interesting is, you know, is they showed me the plans. You know, you can see the airport there and the Cavitex Holdings as the site they meant to propose. When I was trying to explain a deal, by the way, a negotiation, a pre-interview, which they were explaining to me the vitals of the project over Skype text messages in Venice, trying to get across to me exactly what it was they were looking for, they wanted me to put together a short list of master planners who could help them design this 500 hectare site along the Manila waterfront. And when I asked, okay, so you need an architect. You just need me to give you some names for architects. And they insisted, no, we want a master planner. And this was very interesting to me because this sort of was the culmination of a day which I and my interactions with architects have seen long coming, which was they don't want you to design buildings and renderings and schemas. They didn't have an RFP to give the teams that I ultimately assembled for this. They wanted you to write the RFP. They wanted the program on up. They needed someone who could step into that role and design an entire program for the site and then do the master planning for the site because they didn't know what they wanted. They only knew they had rights to dredge 500 hectares of land out of Manila Bay and go from there. And I thought this was fascinating, particularly because I'd been to Manila and I've been there several times. And Manila, you know, for Western architects is sort of terra infirma. You know, this is land. I think, do I have the slide near? I do. Yes. Just a week after I was there in May, you know, Daniel Libeskind went over for the groundbreaking of the Century Spire, which was going to be his contribution to the sort of Manila skyline. And from based on reading the press reports and talking to a friend who covered it, he was greeted like a rock star. Like, you know, that there were cheering crowds hanging out of buildings apparently looking at him, which to me struck me as interesting because it said that there was a dearth of starchitects in the area, that Manila was ripe for this. But I thought it was fascinating in the sense of, you know, they wanted more than just an architect. They not knowing, this property group, what role the architect should be, you know, forced to accept, that of the draftsman and the designer in this, wanted someone who could really create a project from scratch, which I thought was really fascinating. And it was interesting. I can't tell you the names of the teams that's in process, but I could actually listen to these architects, all blue chips, all you would recognize, listen to them try to wrap their heads around the notion of that there was no RFP. They were being asked to invent the project from scratch. And so, you know, this is sort of winding on. The teams are all submitting proposals and went from there. But this was the first thing that happened to me. And of course, you know, it was the perfect timing because there I was in Venice with a bunch of architects, several of whom participation I negotiated with over spritzes at the Hotel Bauer at 2 in the morning. And then I had to call them the next day to say, did you really want to apply for this? Because I can put your name in for that. But you know, the nominal reason I was in Venice was I was there to be interviewed by Hans Ulrich Obrist at the Palazzo Grassi, and I found out later that you know he'd read the first 15 pages of my book on the water taxi ride to the venue, which did not stop him from talking about you know all these sorts of various French philosophers he's read. But I bring him up and I bring this up because he's the curator of the Swiss Pavilion at this Biennale, which Samuel helped me here is devoted to Cedric Price and. Yes, Burkow, an actual Swiss. Cedric Price obviously is not. But it was interesting because, of course, you know, I'm the first to deploy the famous Cedric Price quote, technology is the answer, but what is the question? And that, is, I think, is sort of one of the themes that should be running through my talk and some of the discussion tonight is that, you know, technology is obviously the answer. It's the answer that's been presented to us. It's the only available option in how we approach cities and how we approach infrastructure now. So how are we actually going to apply it and using what forms of public goods? But, you know, Hans Ulrich and I didn't settle that there. And from Venice, you know, after spending several days drinking spritzes with architects, the next week I was in Chicago for NeoCon, which if you're unfamiliar with NeoCon is the equivalent of ICFF or Saloni, but it's for office designers. The stars of the show are Herman Miller and Steelcase and, you know, Vitra and all the sort of corporate interiors companies you know. And, of course, you know, I showed this slide there because the alcove chair, I argued with Vitra, is really the Aeron of its time. This is sort of the defining piece of office furniture now in the sense of trying to create environments that are both, that are ultimately very private and very public, where you can have in a very enclosed space the ability to actually have a sort of quiet place to focus and then work. And I bring this up because, you know, I wasn't actually at NeoCon. I never went to the show floor. I was brought in for a private off-site discussion about the future of activity-based working or hot desking, the whole notion of completely no assigned seats, you know, free-range office workers, and what this would mean for productivity and space and design. I mean, what does it mean when you have an office where no one has an assigned seat or productivity when you're Herman Miller or when you're Steelcase, where you sell very, very expensive pieces of office furniture and do layout design? And this is the sort of thing that was interesting to me, you know, and sitting in a room full of experts about the future of work, that no one was really talking about how work was actually getting done now in the age of ubiquitous digital tools, where we work off 11-inch MacBook Airs and cell phones. You know, where the whole notion of the office, as it was designed 100 years ago or 50 years ago by Mies van der Rohe, is completely dissolving. And now the only difference between the office and the city is a chalk line on the ground, to borrow from a friend's exhibit for the Architectural League from 5 years ago, Breakout. And so to me, this is sort of interesting in the sense of, you know, how do we actually sort of, as architects, as planners, as thinkers about this, how do you design an office that isn't an office? How do you get your head around the notion that people would prefer to work anywhere in a folding chair on a pavement if that's the best place to do work when it's your job to actually design optimal spatial environments? And this is something that the client in this case was not particularly keen to hear, or at least wasn't particularly keen to address. But this to me is, you know, this is to me the project that I'm working on now. One of the things I'm most interested in is the whole notion of what happens when the office returns to the city. If you're familiar with Frank Duffy's research for DEGW and now Strategy Plus ACOM, you know, the estimates, the peak utilization rates of the office towers in Midtown and downtown, you know, what we see as the sort of symbolism of New York, their peak utilization rates are 30 to 40%. I mean, we've basically taken our cities and filled them with structures that are empty the vast majority of the time. Is that success or failure? As someone with no vested stake in this, I kind of see that as failure. And so I'm sort of interested in the notion of, you know, what happens when we start using all of our social media and all of our phones and devices to return that to something like the coffee shop, right? The social media of 1666. And Samuel Pepys was, of course, the first mobile worker when you start reading his diaries. You know, he didn't have a home office. He had an office next door to his house, but he often worked all the time from at court to the docks to, you know, the rural estates of the various noblemen he worked for as a naval bureaucrat to, of course, the pubs and the coffee houses, which were at a time the novel invention, which led to the creation of public space and the public sphere as we know it, if you read Habermas. And today, you know, we've entered, because of social media and because of the cloud, because of our tools, there's a saying that goes around the internet, in the future, everything will be a coffee shop, which is to say that in the future, all you really need is a really comfortable chair from which you can plug into the cloud to do whatever workflow you need to do, and then when you're done with it, you basically want to be in a space that's highly sociable, filled with people, and lots of interesting things going on. And so again, you know, what does this mean for the city? What does this mean for architects? Especially if you follow through with Duffy and you argue, as he has done in his book Work in the City, which came out a few years ago, that architects are all slaves at the mill, producing space endlessly as part of a supply-driven supply chain, in which case you are required to keep putting out Class A office space forever, which, as considering KPF is sponsoring this, that feels kind of heretical to say. All right. Considering Jeff got me into this, sorry, Jeff. But it raises the whole notion of, again, you know, if Duffy is correct here in arguing that, you know, that basically what the rise of digital tools and social media has led to is a notion that we no longer need to be, at least in the context of work, which I'm talking about, we no longer need to be synchronous, and we no longer need to be co-located because of this mediating presence of our digital tools and digital presence. What does it mean for architects, and what does it mean for actually the construction of space? And it means that sort of, you know, this classic diagram he has to show, you know, the, how different levels of a building change, is it, you know, it accelerates even further. We have a whole new level outside of it in the world where we have digital tools able to follow us. And, you know, so it was interesting. While I was in Chicago for NeoCon, I missed this demonstration at the Biennale by a group calling itself the Architecture Lobby. As if to echo Duffy, while we were debating Duffy there in Chicago in a hotel suite, they were standing there with megaphones reading part of this protest. I'll just read a short excerpt. "We can retrace how all of this happened," referring to the disempowerment of architects, "how the profession over the years limited risk and liability, and with it reward and responsibility, how in turn the profession as keepers of design became known only for design. All of the intelligence that is brought to bear on achieving good design, zoning analysis, demographic scrutiny, et cetera, disappears from the ledger when we are paid by the size of the piece. We want to be and should be part of the knowledge economy, not the production economy." And continuing there slightly, "In order to redirect the public's perception of what architects do, we need to reconceptualize our value. We need to walk away from contracts that don't allow us to share in the profit of a building's success. We need to prove that we know that the building's success is determined not by its publication photos, but by its 40-year-long habitability. We need to redefine the way media showcases us, among others." Which, I, you know, reading it today, I got particular chills, because it strikes me as exactly the same sort of thing. What does it mean to be architects where you are part of the holistic solution around it and not just simply putting out another environment, another building? And from there, you know, the week after that, I was in Dallas for the New Cities Summit. The New Cities Summit is a sort of, the New Cities Foundation is another sort of, I think, interesting creature about what we're talking about when it comes to globalization and social media. I mean, this is a mini think tank that came into existence just 2 years ago, stepping into a void between the classic actors like UN Habitat and, of course, you know, consultants like McKinsey to create a new sort of venue and a new space, commissioning research and conveying, you know, both technology companies and cities together to actually meet and discuss these various issues. And, you know, in this case, while I was there in Dallas, you know, I caught up with Cisco, you know, which is, of course, along with IBM, one of the really big two companies that have pushed into the so-called smart city space. And, you know, and I ran into, randomly, the chief globalization officer of Cisco, who I've written about in the past, Wim Elfrink. And, you know, he was very keen to show me some of the latest research, you know, 5 years on that they've been doing. And none of it was particularly radical or new. They were showing me how they were using their digital video cameras to apply to parking, for example, you know, actually using surveillance cameras to follow parking. And so, you know, they've partnered with Streetline, this sort of app, to basically create, to basically find parking spaces in real time. And so, you know, you can be driving around, and rather than circle for parking, you can actually find a space. And what I found interesting about this is it's a very, very short step from the technology side, from the social side, from Parker, which is about activating a public good, parking, to something like Monkey Parking, which was an Italian app that was just finally shut down in San Francisco, which basically allowed users to sell information about parking spaces they occupied to people who might want to park there. Basically, it was... get the joke. It was privatizing parking spaces. And the best line was that the city official said that when they claimed this, we're just selling information, they were saying this is like a prostitute simply selling information about her availability. But it speaks to the whole notion, which scares me about this is, and again, this is a role that as architects and urbanists and planners we should be thinking about, is that when you leave these sorts of decisions to the technologists and to the app makers, to the Ubers and the free marketeers, is you're going to end up with this as a result. We're going to see the privatization of public goods and urban public goods made possible by technology. And, you know, the whole notion of the smart city, you know, boils down to, I've seen a report by Swedish researchers into what they called the hard and the soft. You know, the hard solutions of pure technology and applied technology to make cities 10% more efficient, and the soft, which is about the social public goods. The soft is the part that's being neglected right now and is our real opportunity to step into and say, what does a smart city look like? Because otherwise you end up with this. This is meant to illustrate a city that was proposed for New Mexico a few years ago that was going to be populated purely by robots, where they could test all sorts of smart city solutions. And the reason I wrote about it was because the creator of the city, who was an ex-military defense contractor, said, we don't need people there. We can program algorithms to be more random than the people themselves. And this struck me as a sort of inevitable endpoint of this, and also particularly interesting in the sense of it had autonomous cars. It basically had what Google is proposing to be the sort of ultra-efficient ultra-organized system that will replace the sort of chaos of cities. And I would argue that it's the chaos exactly where the opportunities lie and where we should be thinking about on a global basis. So if you want to see the future of the social and the global, I mean, you should definitely look at places like Nairobi here. This is the Matatu bus terminals there, the Matatus being the sort of dollar vans of sub-Saharan Africa, you know, which basically replaced the formal bus system, which collapsed in the mid-1990s after the government neglected it. And so several years ago, you know, a pair of architects, Sarah Williams, now at MIT, formerly of Columbia, and Jackie Klopp, her colleague, went in using GPS and smartphones with several colleagues, mapped out the digital Matatu networks there, and actually could sort of trace all these informal networks which were formerly invisible at a grand scheme, formerly legible, and made them truly legible. And what I think was really interesting about it was is that more than just you know, the sort of New Yorker piece about the dollar vans, which you may have seen, which rendered them beautifully visually, they recorded all those data points into GTFS, the General Transit Feed, I forget the exact thing, but basically a data layer, which then they could be abstracted to create apps. And so suddenly now you could start building apps on top of this to predict traffic. You could really build sort of public services for an informal public transit system. And this is something, again, which I would only reiterate in this, is like this to me is the future of urbanism and the future of architecture, is working with the resources that are already there, the informal systems that are in place, understanding them, making them legible, understanding how do they fit into the urban context, and using them for best public good. And so I know I'm running over time, but I want to come back to my sort of last point about the social, because I think if you want to talk about the most single most important social app that exists right now, or the most important app for cities, it's Tinder. Who in here is using Tinder right now? Anyone? All right. This never gets a show of hands. I'm glad we have one brave person here. You know, of course, for those of you who are unfamiliar with Tinder, this is what all the kids are into, where you bring up an app on your phone and it shows you in proximity, you can define the radius, you know, who's around you, and you can swipe left or right whether you're interested in them. And to me, it's really interesting because Tinder is an app that only works really in dense cities. This is an app that's optimized to be in places, and we wonder why millennials are moving back to cities. But I want to think about a future. This to me is the sort of future of urban condition of things, is what happens when you take something like Tinder and you made it with Airbnb and you made it with Uber, and suddenly, you know, you suddenly have the sort of real-time availability into seeing the built environment we have, the people who are around us, the transportation assets around us, and how we architect those things together, a piece of information architecture, you could say, in the city. And so, you know, this is just a standard sort of, you know, vision of augmented reality of this, but I think this is increasingly the challenge that faces architects and urbanists is, you know, what happens when the city becomes actionable and visible, where we can start seeing into the spaces that are around us. This sort of, we suddenly create this sort of interstitial space, right, between the real and the virtual, where you can start, suddenly the information that's being made available to you and how is the most important thing in it. Where literally an app like this, if you're wearing it on Google Glass, for example, not only can you reveal things to you, but you can also disappear things to you. You can define the parameters of what is visible and what is not, what is blurred out. And again, this is something that I don't think is a question we should leave to Google or leave the question to the private technologists or the Ubers of the world. It's something that we are going to have to settle. And so just a final thought, you know, I think the future of the city, you know, from the social and global perspective, you know, the social perspective in particular, is we're trending towards Hitoshi Abe's mega house, which he came up with 17 years ago, which imagine, you know, that basically if you took your house and dissolved it into a membership network across the city, where you could basically choose a room on any given day and your membership would allow you to use it. This, to me, is the sort of endpoint of all of what we call the sharing economy, once it's all merged together on the same sort of platform. And so just as a sort of final image of this, this is something that, you know, when it comes to office space, I've been trying to explore with OMA, AMO, and sort of getting a feel for what this means for cities, you know, that, you know, architects, of course, you're working with blue foam all the time. And so to me, the challenge, you know, in the sort of social global city age is what happens when the entire city itself becomes blue foam, and you no longer need to build anything else, but simply carve out the spaces that are there. So thank you very much.
Greg has clearly done this thing before, type of thing before. So parsing through that presentation, there's the kind of opening overture with kind of the Randian dream where, you know, this very rare but exceptional opportunity is presented to an architect where the tabula rasa is kind of there and up to them to kind of, as Greg said, negotiate and develop the program themselves. That's the one thesis, you know, the very rationalist architect type of dream that, you know, all of us kind of harbor, whether we'll admit to it or not. The second, the counterpoint to that talk would be the kind of, you know, which Greg made very explicit at the end of his talk, is just that what happens when architects actually realize or when they use tools to kind of dissect and open up the city and buildings and tools that are already available to them. Whereas, you know, it's not necessarily, it's a provocation to say that architects don't need to build, and obviously we need to, and there are social responsibilities there in terms of housing. You know, housing most of the world is a very urgent priority. But it's also kind of something that is very tantalizing to architects, especially practicing architects, which I realized given the recent Lebius Wood show in New York, which Lebius Woods has kind of, by refusing to participate in this kind of very compromised position, he's kind of gained this sainthood, more or less, among architects, where they can indulge in this type of fantasy, they can kind of align themselves with him living this out, committing this very almost monk-like existence to this refusal, which almost all of us can't participate in. We would, I mean, be out of a job, but an architect with that type of morals is without a job. But I do think that there's something else to be gleaned from Greg's talk, is just that in the few years, I mean, even since 2011, but, you know, I think the question is the honeymoon period over for these types of, you know, for social media, but also internet tools or internet-based tools or crowdsourced tools. There's a lot of opportunity and these things are opening up. The informal opens up a lot of, you know, very obvious and touch points for innovation and creative reuse. At the same time, I think there are very real limitations to crowdsource model, open source model, these types of things where you're replacing a highly bureaucratic system with a very grassroots, pull up your bootstraps, localized solutions that are great, and obviously there's much to be learned from them, but aren't necessarily, let's say, applicable at the level of Manila Bay. So I think there's lots to be parsed through that, Greg's presentations, but learning from what we already have and what we observe, you know, every day at an everyday level, kind of picking apart the buildings and the fabric of the city that we negotiate every day is a very urgent and timely responsibility and job for all of us, which more or less brings me to the next presentation, which will be presented by the two Davids from ArchDaily. I know they may cringe at that classification, but they are there's two, David Basulto and David Assael. They're co-founders of the Plataforma Network and of ArchDaily, which is a subset of that. They are both Chilean architects turned entrepreneurs, I guess, and content producers. They say here their mission is to improve the quality of life for the next 3 billion people moving into cities over the next 40 years by providing knowledge, inspiration, and tools for architects. I've been promised that they've developed an entire new talk for this year, as this will be the third year they presented, so let's hope they live up to that promise. Here are the Davids, if you want to come up. Thanks.
Thank you, Sammy, very much for the presentation. And thank you for the Center for Architecture for having us for the third year already. We're very happy to be here because when we started this project a while ago, when we decided to go global, we said, where should we go? Let's go to New York because it's the center for architecture in the world. And walking down the street, we found the Center for Architecture. So we came here to see all the exhibits and said, would be great to be here someday in the future.
And it has been 3 years that we have been here in the future.
So thank you again to the Center for Architecture for having us.
We want to ask you, how many of you have been here the year before for our lecture? Can you raise your hand, please?
The hair keeps getting shorter.
Like 10. Or the year before? 1, 2.
Very few.
We can repeat the presentation. Yeah, because we haven't done much in 1 year.
No, but for us, the topic is very exciting.
Thank
Globalization.
You.
We're coming from Chile, from the periphery of the world, and we're having a global perspective on the world, and this is what we want to tell you. What have these people from Chile been doing, how we're embracing architecture worldwide, and what we think that is going to happen.
First of all, we're very sorry for our English. We're from Chile. In Chile, we learn Spanish. We don't learn English, and the education is not very good.
But for sure, our English teacher would have been so proud to see that we're doing a lecture in English in front of so many architects.
That's really true.
So, given that not so many people have seen the previous lectures, we're going to quickly go through what is ArchDaily. Today is the most visited source of information for architects on the internet, and it started because of this. When we were young architects, we saw that this is what every young architect wants to be in the cover of these magazines, not because it's going to fulfill your ego as an architect, but because it's going to mean a lot of opportunities for you.
Also it's going to fulfill your ego.
For sure. And you're going to get invited to restricted competitions, you're getting to get a lot of commissions. One of your biggest issues is going to be how to grow your practice.
And a lot of parties.
And what about the young, talented architect living in Chile or on any other emerging country at that time? We started in 2006, and what we were seeing is that in our country, there were very talented architects, but they weren't part of the circle of opportunities. They didn't have access to this. But what happened? Let's say a certain Chilean architect goes to do a master's in Venice, gets to know the editors of these renowned magazines, and he becomes the link with Chilean architecture. And if he knows about your work, he's going to recommend you, write an article, and you could have a slight chance to enter the circle's opportunities. But what if he doesn't know about your work? You're out. So, given the power of the internet, free publishing, the network effect, we said, let's start a website, which was first Plataforma Arquitectura in Spanish, in which we wanted to feature the best architecture first in our context, in Chile, with the young architects doing interesting things, the guys in Argentina, in Peru. And we saw that thanks to the internet, we could create a place for exposure, for debate, and most important, that we had the thought that we could generate opportunities for them in the same way as this other network was doing. So we started to feature the work of these young architects, and we saw the network effect happen right away, because they started to tell their friends, hey, my work has been featured on Plataforma Arquitectura, go and see it, started to share it, and very soon we found that they started to connect among themselves. At the very beginning, the internet was the first, the blogs were the first place where you could share comments, share knowledge, and architects were sharing like technical solutions. How did you did the skylight? How did you resolve the structure? And this network effect started to happen and connecting every peer. And all of a sudden we found, and this was in 2006, that we started to become the fresh source of information for this architectural network, the magazines that we were using as the base. The editors from Habitare, from Domus, started to ask us, who's this young architect? What are they doing? Can you point me to
Domus
them?
Domus is amazing.
And at that time, not so many architects had their website, so we became like the trader of Latin American innovative architects. And one of the peaks of this effect was this. Do you anyone knows this project? This is a library in Medellin, in the middle of the slums. These three black rocks were designed by a young architect unknown at that time, thanks to a public competition. His name was Giancarlo Massanti, who one day just sent us an email through our contact form and told us, I just finished this library, here are my photos, like very tilt ones, not very focused, but the project was amazing. And we published it, and we remember this date very well, the 19th of February of 2008. Because only 3 days after, he sent us this email. Dear David, I'd like to thank you for featuring the libraries on your website. The site has a big audience and reach, and I've been contacted by more than 14 publications from around the world to publish my work after seeing it on platform. And Giancarlo told us that these were magazines from Italy, China, Japan, and the US. And we were in Spanish. So at that time we saw that this thing that we were trying to open opportunities to the architects in our context, was working. And most important, it was reaching people outside of our language.
At that time we have 5,000 visits per day.
And we were at the end of the world, surrounded by the mountains, by the ocean, more than 10 hours away from any capital in the world. But it was happening. These young, crazy Chilean architects doing something on the internet to give opportunities to other architects started to work. And someone made a ranking about architecture websites on the internet. And our website in Spanish was the most read in the Spanish language. And we were very curious because in Spain, there's an amazing publication tradition. El Croquis, Tectónica, Metalocus, amazing magazines are coming from there. So we thought that it was obvious that the disruption on the internet, the publication magazines, should have come from Spain. But no, it was coming from there, from Chile, from the end of the world, a place with no networks, a place forgotten when the internet arrived only a few years before.
We didn't know that was the end of the world up to the moment that we started buying tickets for going to other countries.
And then we understand this, that more than a website and a publication, what we were doing is to build a hub of opportunities. People were coming in, opportunities were going out, were being spread, and the concept for hub as a hub was very important for us. But we had a boundary. We knew that this had a lot of potential. And by then, for us, it was obvious that maybe being in English could take us to the world. So we said, the very innocent way that brought us to New York, to stumble upon a center for architecture. So we started in English with this. ArchDaily, because architectural platform was a very long name, so we had to find something shorter and more precise.
You know, in internet, you don't write too much.
Exactly. So after a few weeks thinking about the name, we say, obviously, ArchDaily, we publish things every day, so. And the goal was to do the same, but in English, the biggest hub of opportunities for architects. We understood that location was not a problem anymore. As you've seen, for us, we were very obsessed about where we were going in, about where we're coming from in the end of the world. And we went through a very rapid growth, very exponential. This is the internet, where things happen in this way. And over these years, we have done more than 300 interviews, published more than 20,000 projects. We have gotten a lot of architects' feedback, growing on Twitter with the architectural discussion, millions actually of fans on Facebook, 7 million monthly visits, 70 million page views, making us an influential source of architecture in the internet. And this came through, well, as I told you, in our Spanish website, and then on English. But then we started to notice very important shifts in the world that are much more bigger than all these figures that I showed you before, that led us to open in 2011 ArchDaily Brazil, then ArchDaily Mexico, and then ArchDaily China. And why? Why this is what's happening from this forgotten place at the end of the world.
Something very important is that we were starting from Santiago de Chile. Santiago de Chile is in this place. Have you been in Santiago de Chile? Who, can you raise your hand, please? A lot of people, like 7. This is a lot, really. So in one moment, I don't know why, we said, why this map is like this? And it's not like this. Really. You know that the universe doesn't have an up and down. Or if it happens, the one that it invented was living probably here or here, but was not living like here. So we said, it's much more easier to go down than up. So what if we change this map in our mind and we go down? So we change this map in our mind, in our office, in our wall. We put it in our wall and we said, what if we start going down? And what if we go to these places? So we started and we were invited to many places. We have been to since the King of Saudi Arabia. This is our main clone in China. We have been, I don't know if you know this guy. He just resigned last month for his work in Spain. We have been in many countries, visiting many princes, kings, presidents, and so on. For us, it has been like a movie. Our team from 9 countries is formed by architects, designers, economists, computer science engineers, and journalists, who really are architecture geeks, big data nerds, city lovers, new media evangelists, bike advocates, proud citizens, and big dreamers. This is part of our dream. This is part of our dream in Santiago de Chile. We have people in 9 countries that are really hard workers. For example, we just start China. We have 8 people in China. And we understand that the world is growing fast. In 2013, the 50%, more than 50% of the people, that is 3.3 billion people, is living on cities. For 2050, the 75% of the world, that is 6.6 billion of people, is going to live in cities. So it's going to be the double. In less than 40 years, it's going to be the double of people living on cities. There are more people living inside this circle than outside of it. That is amazing. This is happening nowadays. This is how the urban world is growing. This is how people is living in cities. This 2010, 2020, 2030, 2040, 2050. Are you understanding this? Look, China, India. Please look, US, Mexico, Brazil. Look, Chile. Is not in the map. I'm sorry. Our mission, it means ArchDaily's mission, is to give information and tools to architects to design a better urbanized world. Since last year, we have visited Brazil. This is Brazil, you know. I don't know if you know the World Cup. Soccer, football. Russia, this is Russia. Mexico, the Zócalo in Mexico. Indonesia, the market in Indonesia. The wall in China. And we saw a lot of things, for sure. We meet a lot of people, we did lectures, we start operations, we hire people, but we saw a lot of things and we select this. In Brazil, we saw this. In Russia, we saw this. In Mexico, we saw this. In Indonesia, we saw this. In China, we saw this. If you don't believe, see the typography in Chinese. But it was not only the same stores. It was the same clothing, really. So in winter, people got exactly the same clothing everywhere because of Zara, because of H&M, because every store that is around the world that is delivering exactly the same clothing. And it's not about clothing. It's about everything. But if we are here in New York, we really doesn't notice. The question for us is, why is everyone in the world getting the same stuff? Why? Because it's possible. In one hand, we got this increase in offer. It means technology in fabrication, plus distribution, logistics, and a big et cetera. There is Zara. Do you know Zara? Maybe a lot of you got something from Zara. Maybe a jacket, a t-shirt, a shirt, pants, whatever. This is the logistic and distribution place in La Coruña. We have been here talking with the founder. This place you cannot imagine. 1 million square meters of distribution and logistics. It means that they are taking things that are fabric or made in many places in the world. In Spain, they are organized and redistributed through this place to the world. Through this, through cars, trucks, and planes. They are very proud to tell you that in 1 week or 10 days, they can put a t-shirt from this place to your city, even Santiago de Chile, in the store. That is amazing. That is really amazing. We got this also. Maybe you have heard about Jeff Bezos talking about the drones with Amazon. For us, it's amazing at the same time that it's scary. Amazon now has 1 day delivery. I don't know if you have seen the last Amazon documentary. They are talking about 1 hour delivery. 1 hour delivery, can you imagine that? That is amazing. You can have whatever you want in 1 hour. So it is increasing offer plus increasing demand. How do you get increasing demand? It's Hollywood plus media plus TV plus internet. So we were thinking about this when we found an amazing documentary. That is The Century of the Self. Do you know The Century of the Self? Have you ever watched The Century of the Self?
Or heard about Edward Bernays?
No? Can you raise a hand who have watched this? Like, 5. Amazing. It's a 2002 documentary from the BBC. Amazing. For Chile, BBC is like God. So here is a selection from us. Oh, there's no audio.
To experiment with the minds of the popular classes. His most dramatic experiment was to persuade women to smoke. At that time, there was a taboo against women smoking. And one of his early clients, George Hill, the president of the American Tobacco Corporation, asked Bernays to find a way of breaking it.
Can you do anything about that? I said, let me think about it. And then I said, have I your permission to see a psychoanalyst to find out what cigarettes mean to women? So I called up Dr. Brill, A.A. Brill, who was a leading psychoanalyst in New York at that time.
A.A. Brill was one of the first psychoanalysts in America. and for a large fee, he told Bernays that cigarettes were a symbol of the penis and of male sexual power. He told Bernays that if he could find a way to connect cigarettes with the idea of challenging male power, then women would smoke, because then they would have their own penises. Every year, New York held an Easter Day parade to which thousands came, and Bernays decided to stage an event there. He persuaded a group of rich debutantes to hide cigarettes under their clothes. Then they should join the parade, and at a given signal from him, they were to light up the cigarettes dramatically. Bernays then informed the press that he had heard that a group of suffragettes were preparing to protest by lighting up what they called torches of freedom.
And so the next day, this was not just in all of the New York papers, it was across the United States and around the world. And from that point forward, the sale of cigarettes to women began to rise. He had made them socially acceptable with a single symbolic act.
What Bernays had created was the idea that if a woman smoked, it made her more powerful and independent. An idea. It meant that irrelevant objects could become powerful emotional symbols of how you wanted to be seen by others.
Eddie Bernays saw the way to sell product was not to sell it to your intellect, that you ought to buy an automobile, but that you will feel better about it if you have this automobile. I think he originated that idea.
General Motors Parade of Progress, traveling the high roads and by roads of America, bringing to millions of Americans in their own hometowns the fascinating story behind modern industry.
The campaign set out to show dramatically that it was business, not politicians, who had created modern America.
A better mode of living for all of us.
Bernays was an advisor to General Motors, but he was no longer alone. The industry he had founded now flourished as hundreds of public relations advisors organized a vast campaign. They not only used advertisements and billboards, but managed to insinuate their message into the editorial pages of the newspapers. In 1939, New York hosted the World's Fair. Edward Bernays was a central advisor. He insisted that the theme be the link between democracy and American business. At the heart of the fair was a giant white dome that Bernays named Democracy. And the central exhibit was a vast working model of America's future, constructed by the General Motors Corporation.
Hello, you notice the subtitles? If not in Chile, we don't understand nothing. So in a way, how we spread this like to the world? Because it's hot, because of Hollywood. In Chile, that we are at the end of the world, this is our cinema, for sure. This is internet. This is how we spread content to the world. These are the movies that we see and the brands that we consume. I don't know if you saw this movie. I saw it. I really like FedEx. And also like Starbucks. It's another movie. So the result is this. During the last century, a big part of the world has been buying a lifestyle that has shaped our cities in an inefficient and very unsustainable way. To live in suburbs gives you a better quality of life than the city center. Have you think about this? Or to own a car is to have freedom instead of a public transport and walking. Glass towers are symbols of progress instead of local traditional architecture. Here we got pictures from Germany, China, Switzerland, Italy, France, Netherlands, Saudi Arabia, Russia, Indonesia, Japan, Nigeria, and United Kingdom. You can imagine the other countries in the world. Here we got examples from one architect doing buildings in Hanoi, Vietnam, San Francisco in the US, Hong Kong, China. You know who is his architect or not? We also got one of these buildings in Santiago de Chile. This architect is Cesar Pelli, he's Argentinian, he's our neighbor. And we have written a lot about this building. This is the tallest building in South America. It's in Santiago de Chile, and you can see at the top a very big building. Probably you can say it's not so bad, a glass building. At the bottom, we got a big shopping center, the biggest shopping center in Santiago de Chile.
In Latin America, actually.
I'm sorry. And this shopping center is in a central area. What does this shopping center did to our central area? It killed it. Really, it killed it. We got before a lot of activities, so on. One day this shopping center arrived. Nothing else happens. We were saying before, look, this is going to happen, this is going to happen, and it happened. This is globalization in one hand.
We're seeing the downfall of globalization. And as global citizens, people coming from the periphery, we're understanding it. In a way, we're trying to approach it from our editorial side, try to understand which are the trends of the future city, walkability, turning freeways into public space. How can suburbia be more urban? What the heck is happening with skyscrapers around the world? A skyscraper that is so big that even didn't fit in the slide.
Which is the relation between skyscrapers, ego, and sex?
Because in the same way that people wanted to have the car, sheikhs want to have the tallest tower. Sheikhs want to have the shiny glass tower in the middle of the dusty desert. And to import the global idea of progress instead of looking back to the real sustainable solutions that are happening there, in a way trying to kill their tradition. And for sure, green architecture is thrown in the middle with the LEED ratings and so on.
For us, green architecture is amazing, like about points and so on.
But at the end, we understand that as a media, as the most consulted website for architecture on the internet, we are part of the problem. Because we're broadcasting architecture to the whole world at the beginning in a very undifferentiated way. We wanted to go out to the world, to be the main source, to accumulate all the architecture, all the knowledge, all the details, all the drawings, but in a very, we were flattening the architecture world. And we're working hard to be part of the solution because at the end, having 320,000 daily visits, okay, it's good for our ego, but it set us to a very big responsibility. And the question is how? Well, first, to focus on the local architecture and its innovations. In a way, at the beginning, we started to broadcast architecture from the centers to the developed world. But it is impressive how architects in the US and in Europe are telling us, guys, you're opening us, our mind, by seeing what is happening in Indonesia, what is happening in Turkey, what is happening in the developing world. Because at the end, in the developing world is where people have more restrictions, and that makes innovation flourish. So it has allowed us to open an awards program that is curated by our readers. It doesn't have like a group of esteemed judges. It's just our readers, who are actually voting and naming the best buildings of the year, a mixed use project by OMA, along with this, with local architecture in Thailand, that is serving the people there with local materials, with local solutions, with their local religion, as the cow depicts in this picture. How ventilation is happening in subtropical countries, or how you can build a school with $200 in Ecuador.
They are al borde amazing architects from Ecuador.
And as architects in the developing world are being influenced through the renowned magazines by the established practices, we have established a two-way bridge with the emerging world, and architects in the developed world are using these examples as inspiration. Second, to highlight the difference between contexts and cultures. We all know what happened with the international style that tried to flatten everything, that tried to come with a style that could be used in Santiago de Chile, in New York, in Hanover, in Shanghai.
I'm coming from Marseille. Just the day before yesterday, I was in Marseille. It's amazing, the Unité Habitationnelle de Marseille. Do you know what I mean? Like Le Corbusier. You really like Le Corbusier?
And Foster and Saha.
And everyone. But we don't want to see the same stuff everywhere because it doesn't fit. People doesn't need the same stuff everywhere.
And that's why we showed you that at some point we came up with this, with ArchDaily Brazil, an emerging economy that, thanks to the World Cup, you have seen all their struggles, the social problems that have to do with public space, with housing, with infrastructure. And how can we deliver a knowledge and an architectural content that is suitable for them?
In Brazil, the people architects have developed so much knowledge related to favelas, to urban space, to local places that we have to learn from.
Gladly, the glass tower is not so widespread in Sao Paulo, and it's still the mass inspiration from the local modernism. But it is at risk, and we have the responsibility, and that's why we did ArchDaily Brazil. That's why we launched ArchDaily China, with this, the country that it's almost 40% of the floor space that is going to be built in the future. It's going to happen there. And they, in the US, you know how many registered architects there are? It's close to 200,000. But in China, with a 1.3 billion population, there is only 30,000 architects. So they are importing architecture, and at the same time, they are forming the new generation of architects that during these last 2 years, they are graduating and constantly growing in an exponential way. And we need to be available for them in their language with what they need. Same with ArchDaily Mexico, a bustling economy, growing in more than 100 million citizens in a distributed way in many regions. And for sure, they also need knowledge to build what the growth of the country needs.
So we're trying hard to build ArchDaily in each big economy. And we are happy that we have a big representative here from Mexico, and Arquine and Andrea. Thank you for being here.
And the third point is to understand how the next generation of architects are going to learn. Because for sure, it's not going to be the same way as you did, as we did. And we're helping to build the source of the contents. ArchDaily, you can see it as an iceberg. At the top is what you go and see on the front page. But below, it's so big. It's all these 20,000 projects that we show, and all the comments and the exchange of opinions, all the details, all the drawings. And in between,
and this is important, like because what we are seeing every day in ArchDaily is the 0.2% of our content, or maybe less. This is what we see, and it's difficult to imagine what is behind.
Below, you will find the Bauhaus on their daily classics section, the Russian constructivism, classics, a lot of building systems, a lot of technical data, and so on. But our question is, how are we going to learn the techniques, how this website, this cold thing floating on the internet, can play a more active role?
Because in a way, we think that we can be the source of the content, but the content is not enough for the architect's formation. So the question is, what about the technique? So, what about these people? You know these people? Probably you know three of them or not. Can you raise the hand who knows the four of them, please? The fourth. Really amazing. So there's Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, Mark Zuckerberg. They have in common, you know what they have in common? Know that they are billionaires, because they are. They are dropouts of school. Some that have never started school. The others are finished before ending. But for us, the more interesting is this guy. You know this guy? Palmer Luckley. Have you heard about him? This kid is about to change gaming, movies, TV, music, design, architecture, medicine, sex. Sports, art, travel, social networking, education, and reality. Maybe it was too much. The Oculus Rift is here, and it will blow your mind. Do you know what is Oculus Rift? This guy started a company called Oculus Rift when he was 18 years. Now he's 21. He didn't went to school, not to college or to university, to school. I don't know, in Chile it doesn't happen.
No? Doesn't exist.
His parents taught him about life, school, mathematics, whatever.
Homeschooling.
And this guy, at 18 years old, he built virtual reality system, and at 21 was bought by Facebook at $2 billion, that is a lot of money, that was some month ago. What it means more than money and whatever is that this is our future. It's difficult to understand. Please go to internet and try to understand it. We have been talking about 20 years about virtual reality. We have been talking about Doom playing, a lot of plays, and so on. It never happened. This is the start about virtual reality. And how is it going to happen? Because he tried 50 different ways to do it, tried in internet, and finally he got it. And now you can use his glasses and don't be sick using virtual reality. So Facebook bought it, and we can go to another dimension because of this kid that he never went to university, to college, or to school. What about these people? You know what they have in common? You know them. Probably you know one, two, three. You're amazing if you know four. Can you raise your hand if you know the four of them, please? Amazing. These are four of the most amazing architects in the world. They have in common that they have not gone to school of architecture, or they have not finished school for architecture. So we got that their some amazing architects that have never studied architecture. So our question is, who is going to be the architect of the future? Who is going to be the architect that is going to design the cities that we need?
The disruptor of architecture.
The cities that are think about, that are thought about quality of life, not about the big glass buildings, not about ego, about quality of life, about which is the optimum, about transportation, commerce, and life. And that's it. So if you got feedback, ideas, projects, or dreams, please just send them to
us.
Thank you very much. And if you want to contact us by Twitter or Instagram, you got it here. Thank you.
It's incredibly gratifying to think that ArchDaily has its origins in a century of the self, for me. I think a lot of the points that the two Davids talked about will address in the panel discussion that will proceed momentarily. I think we'll just go right into introducing the panelists. Two of whom you see on the screen, they're both stepping in. One is Jaime Derringer. Can you just write, I mean, are you the bottom left corner? Okay. She's the founder and editor of the modern design blog, Design Milk, which I'm sure you've all seen. She's written in various publications, including the LA Times, Time Out New York, and San Francisco Chronicle. She recently launched a modern design blog for called Dog Milk for dog lovers who have a particular penchant for a uniquely modern sense of style, apparently. And then above is Diana Jo. She's a video journalist and multimedia editor at the Wall Street Journal. She's a producer for Asia Daily and Digits, a consumer technology show for Wall Street Journal Live. Her latest project for WallStreetJournal.com is an interactive museum on Kowloon Walled City, which I'm sure she'll talk about tonight. And I guess I can bring the rest of the panelists up here. The first one is, you know Greg? Rafi Segal is the next. His practice encompasses design and research on both the architectural and urban scale. He's the associate professor of architecture and urbanism at MIT. Recently, he won the international competition for the National Library of Israel in Jerusalem, which you may have seen that Ayal Weissman wrote about. Mark Collins is here. He's a design architect, teacher, programmer, and principal of Proxy Design Studio. His work has been featured in numerous publications, including Gizmodo, ArchDaily, Architect Magazine, and so on. He's also the founder of the Morpholio Project, as well as an adjunct assistant professor at GSAP, or Columbia GSAP. He currently directs the GSAP Cloud Lab. The next is Kyle over there, standing against the wall. He's a practicing architect in New York City and co-founder and editor-in-chief of Clog Journal. He has He's been a visiting critic at a number of schools, including Princeton, Columbia GSAP, and the University of Illinois. And then there are the two Davids. So, hello, everyone. I think, just to start off, I think the number one thing, and that was kind of illustrated by the ArchDaily presentation, is how much design has kind of tapped into this, what has been kind of the design blog, which kind of appeared maybe a decade ago, but in a very small, with a very small audience, and how much these design blogs have been kind of achieved a wide audience. Everyone from Fast Company to Wired to even Business Week now has a design vertical. The flip side to that would be that ArchDaily design a design places like this that are that kind of grew out of this information sharing and publicizing side of things now has good original content, opinion columnist, and so on. So I think what the Davids touched on is how much when they admit that they are part of the problem, which is a good thing because they know that they're adapting to the kind of a changing world of criticism and of practice that I think most of these, that is essential to this kind of thing. Saying that, I guess we can just begin with the questions. The first one, I think, which has probably been covered in previous iterations of Viral Voices, but the first one, just to kick things off, would be what does design gain from this kind of increased exposure? Are designers transforming or changing in order to receive social media attention? How do they react to the attention that they're given and the comments that have been fielded towards them? And are these transformations helping or hurting the projects? I'll open it up to everyone, but I think maybe Diana wants to say something. She indicated beforehand.
Thanks, everyone, for having me. I'm calling in from Hong Kong. Like you guys said before, many publications have been previously focused just on one topic, you know, design or tech, now have created new platforms to broadcast their design ideas on the web. So what you might consider niche design stories are actually being blown to full-scale interactive experiences. And for publications like the Wall Street Journal, which people usually go to gain corporate earnings report, they're actually getting, web projects that are dedicated to architecture. The Wall Street Journal didn't even really have photos on the front page of the print paper till after 2001. Now we have very popular sections called House of the Day, Mansions, and a slew of other design and lifestyle columns. And last year, one of my colleagues launched For Architecture's Sake. It's an interactive where a Chinese billionaire invited 24 renowned architects to design, you know, a fantasy land of houses, unique houses, just for the sake of art. And we gave it a full visual treatment with videos, slideshows, glossy photos, 360s, pictures of the sketches and the models. I think that's just an example of sort of where the journal has come and how they also want a piece of the design culture and the traffic and the traction that it has gained online. And this year I worked on the Cowanwalt City, which is, for those of you that are not familiar with, it's basically a labyrinth, a lawless labyrinth that was torn down 20 years ago. at its peak, it had 33,000 people in the area of 6.5 acres, and it was the densest place on Earth. And to give you an idea of what that density might feel like, if replicated, it would be a little bit over 3 million people in one square mile. So, and it was an architectural marvel because it was done without a central planner. There's 500 buildings, all interlocked, sharing foundations, walls, staircases, entryways. So architects and also academics were really, really fascinated by it. And as journalists, we took this architecture and academic obsession into basically a 5-month long investigative story. We dig deeper into all the myths and found never before published footage and photos. So, architects, I think, should really embrace sort of these producers and audiences outside of the design industry. And obviously the Wall Street Journal is outside of that design industry. And, for us, the large publications, they can afford sort of these resources and time to develop, something deeper than a blog post or more stimulating than a PowerPoint.
I wonder what the decision, the motivation was to kind of land on a subject like Kowloon Walled City. I think everyone in the audience is probably familiar with that phenomenon, really. But how it's been covered on every blog imaginable, most likely. But in terms of an investigative story, is that where the primacy of the journal can come about? How can it explore that differently than other design blogs?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. We were positioned in Hong Kong where we, interviewed 20 or so people that either lived there or studied it or was very involved in the creation of Kowloon Walled City. But also, the Wall Street Journal has strategically been really interested in lifestyle and other topics. It's trying to be more of a general interest paper. So we have our core financial coverage, but also they have fashion columns. They have TV show summaries. And design is just part of the strategy. So for Kowloon Walled City, it was a great mix of architecture, history, sociology. It had all of that. And what we were able to do, what some of these other sites weren't doing, like the Daily Mail, or they just had photos, really, and descriptions. But they didn't really spend the time to talk to all the people that lived there. We spoke to informal developers that ended up developing 20-some buildings in Kowloon Walled City that weren't actually even architects. We got footage that were filmed by a Fulbright scholar at that time of Kowloon Walled City that filmed every single pathway in the building and mapped it out systematically, and that she took architecture plans of these places. So we had all this information. We went to the public records office and found not only old photos, but the demolition plans, which they took a census of everyone that got compensated for their business and their homes. So, we took this fascinating place and really delved deeper. And a lot of the blogs and a lot of the forums online misreported a lot of the information. And it just sort of took on the myths of the sex and the drugs, all that, and made it into a larger than life place. But when we actually talked to people, they said, oh, the sex and the drugs, they were only really 10, 15 years of the period in the span of 100 years. And afterwards, it was much controlled and more or less normal than the compared to the rest of Hong Kong. So I think that was a a great thing for the journal to do, to be able to spend, you know, 5 months and to place, you know, essentially six people full-time on staff to dedicate a lot of resources to something that maybe other publications can't afford to do.
I mean, it's definitely true that I think a lot of blogs some of these newer blogs that are attached to more traditional publications are very much aware of the fact that they can't offer deep reporting, or that some pieces can't, or deep reporting can't be assigned to every piece given the amount of content that they're expected to create on a daily basis.
Exactly.
I mean, I think the trade-off is that, or the kind of mitigated solution is that a lot of these sites are actually doing reporting, but they're doing minimal reporting, or they're talking to just the project architect, which I'm sure many of architects are happy that they only speak to them as sources. But is there anyone up here with the rest of the at the panel that can speak to that? I mean, I think the other thing that Dana touched on was architecture as lifestyle, this kind of category, almost kind of, and not to say anything about that, it's just a rampant kind of easy classification. How is that kind of, what does that do to the profession, or what effects does that have for architects or practicing architects, and how they see themselves, but also how they work and how they publicize their work online? No one on the Greg?
I'll take that one quickly about the lifestyle aspect, because as a journalist, I've just seen this quickly. I was asked, it's interesting, for example, so I worked with Rafi on a project for MoMA a couple years ago with Jeannie Gang. We were on the same team for Foreclosed, Rehousing the American Dream. And so that's how I got to know Rafi and how I got to know Jeannie Gang and several other Astrogates and many great people. And it was my first experience working on the other side. But it was interesting because as a journalist, it's given me the opportunity then to follow up with Jeannie in particular, who... she's not quite a star architect. It would never accept that title, but is sort of in those ranks. And so there's been a lot of attention, a lot of press attention towards her. So I interviewed her for WSJ, the monthly, I think, luxury magazine of the Wall Street Journal, and you know, basically structured an interview as essay, and it turned out very well. But I thought it was interesting that Jeannie then turned down an approach by Departures magazine, the luxury magazine sent to Amex Platinum card holders, because they wanted to basically appropriate Jeannie as purely a curator of taste. What are your five favorite things? And just lay them out there. And I think she was right in her apprehension of it to be reduced to the caricature of a pure tastemaker, that there's a trivialization that the whole sort of notion of, you know, of design as lifestyle carries with it. And, you know, and in any case, it all worked out in the end because Jeannie turned it down, but Bjarke was more than happy to do it.
Talking about Bjarke, I guess the next point we can come up with, and this is something that's been brought up with previous iterations of our voices, but the kind of hyper-information that all of us are bombarded with constantly. Here the factoid is that there are more active phones than people on the planet, over 7 billion subscriptions, and that will increase in the coming years. So because we're sharing at this kind of unprecedented rate, what are the pros and cons of this kind of mass production of information, but also mass consumption of information? Rafi, do you want to speak to that?
Right. So maybe to continue on that, architecture as lifestyle, right? I'm going to break down this question to two questions, actually. One is the relation between information and design, kind of very broad. And when we talk about information today, we cannot disconnect it from digital information. This is one question. And the other kind of question or point is, I would say, maybe the danger or the problematics, let's say, of confusing information with knowledge. And knowledge, I mean in the broad sense, knowledge as a means to wisdom. Let's kind of say it in those words. and whether, you know, architecture as a lifestyle at all participates in that. And referring more to the question of what does, let's say, building take part in? Does it take part in a world of information, or does it take a role in a system of knowledge, which leads into a kind of a set of values? Almost to bring the reference of what, like, Harold Bloom refers to as a 19th century novel, as a carrier of a set of values that describe or remind us of morals, certain ways in which we are to behave, et cetera, et cetera. So does architecture at all, does it have a chance to participate in that kind of system, in that body of knowledge? And I had a great image to show, which is not up here, but I can describe it. And imagine our current tablet, let's say the iPad, and imagine the Babylonian tablet, if you have that in mind, which is probably about 4,000 years old, but surprisingly, very similar. In the same, almost I would say exactly the same size and the same shape. I would say almost exactly the same design, right? But they're two very different tablets, right? One is kind of a portal to our wonderful, amazing world of information, and the other, you know, the data there was written in stone, was kind of carved in stone, right? So you could see under the bright sun, kind of, you know, what you're reading. But in fact, they both were the same, almost the same tools. They were both kind of wonders when they were introduced, and they both held information. They were tools. I mean, the Babylonian tablet held just numbers. It's kind of like accounting information, most worthless. The iPad, I would argue, is nothing but a tool of information. It carries no value, no cultural value in itself. It carries no part in the construction of knowledge, which is a discussion, which is a cultural discussion that maintains the set of values or a system of values. Now, what is the potential for design in this kind of shift in the digital information age? And here I kind of conclude briefly with a point to think about is what that does to architecture. What the digital information does to architecture, what the digital age in general does to architecture, and I would argue it liberates architecture. It liberates form exactly away from the image, because we do not need the kind of the recent, more historical tie of function to form is no longer relevant, right? I mean, the digital age allows information to be accessed and our lifestyle to change without the formulas or the kind of prescribed forms that we inherited from the 20th century. So it's a liberator in a way, but that's kind of to carry on.
No, it is. But I think there's another thing that you brought up with that, how to distinguish between information and knowledge. More practically, how do you even, you know, kind of parse through those things on a daily basis when you're, or maybe say, as Jaime does on a daily basis, just kind of creating content every day. How can you kind of tell whether one is one or the other, or is it even important for you, for someone online, for a design site like Design Milk, to go through that process? Jaime?
Oh, I'm sorry. Hi. I have a couple things to say about this. I was just thinking, you know, we pass a lot of information. We're not an educational site, so, I mean, we're not, you know, passing knowledge to people around the world. We're just passing information. But I think that there comes a point where this globalization of information, I mean, we can all admit that this is awesome, that all of this sharing is wonderful, and all of this information that's being dispersed globally is wonderful. But there comes a point where it just becomes very challenging to keep up with everything that's happening. You know, there are companies and architects and, you know, manufacturers in other countries that don't even have social media yet. They're not, you know, they don't understand it. So there's a lot of disconnect. They're not involved in that global conversation yet. So there's definitely a disadvantage. I'm actually answering another question, but I'll get back to your question in a second. And on top of that, there's this fear of missing out from the rest of us. I think there's this, it's called FOMO. So, you know, if you are left behind, are you really truly left behind? Even if you're creating something that's innovative and interesting and different, you know, if you're not involved in that global conversation, you know, online, are you actually still doing things that are behind what everybody else is doing? And I think it's extremely important for us to pass information as much and as quickly as possible on our site. But also, I think starting conversations to get people to understand that they have to become part of this global conversation online. You know, like I mentioned, there's a lot of companies that just aren't doing it yet. And we really have to get out there and say, you know, as an architect or as a firm or as a company, this social presence may not seem very important to you at the moment, but will become important to you and your business and the survival of your business in the future as this global conversation just gets bigger and bigger and as the population goes toward 8 billion. So that's one thing I just wanted to get out of the way. And going back to your, I'm sorry, can you repeat your original question?
Shauna, in that you kind of admitted that it's more information sharing and that it is kind of this way to ward off this creeping feeling of FOMO, which everyone online experiences. But I think to tie or go back to a bit of Rafi's point, how does this kind of information sharing or this proliferation of information, and this is something I'm sure we've all talked about it amongst ourselves, but what does this do to criticism? Does it kill it? Does it abet it? Does it contribute to its development online? Or does it assume new forms? I think Mark might know this since developer at the lab or cloud lab.
Yeah, I'll be glad to feel that just because we do have some interesting insights, not only coming out of the cloud lab, which is looking at architectural technologies and how not only the kinds of work that we can do enabled by this new digital infrastructure of the cloud, but you know, how we work, how we share, how we critique. So, you know, we've been talking a lot about the blog today and the web, and, you know, I'm reminded of this Marshall McLuhan quote of the medium is the message. And of course, the web is a hypertextual environment, so we're talking about text and imagery. So it's no surprise that we get kind of inundated with those two things. It also is no surprise because, of course, the brain has these very evolved centers for dealing with those kinds of media, and those are really the sort of high-throughput ways into the brain, which is interesting. So the web, if we think about its medium being text and imagery, then, of course, you get glossy images, you get comments, you get the like button, and all of these ways of, in a sense, trying to engage or trying to give your attention or some kind of understanding with the media you're engaging with. I think device culture is actually a really interesting departure point from that. So the devices that are just now outnumbering us one-to-one, but eventually will vastly outnumber us, are a very different thing to me than the web, just because of their orientation to mobility, the kind of almost intimate connection that we have with all these devices that we're carrying around, right? We carry them with us. They're always on. They're always, in a sense, kind of monitoring and listening to us. So I think that is a different jumping off point. And the Morpholio project, which on the one hand is just prosaically this series of apps, but on the other hand is this really ambitious project to reshape design culture and how we design, has been thinking about how mobility and mobile technology in specifically could, in a sense, enhance or add volume to this idea of criticism and critique. And of course, there's different opportunities with mobile. So again, they're always on. They're always following us around. We can unlock certain discussions or experiences based on where you are. We can do, we recently had a research project at Morpholio where we actually monitored someone's heart rate through the iPhone as they're being exposed to different images. And, you know, we can talk about whether or not that becomes a form of critique. So as we start to harness more of those signals, that of course we're always signaling in many different ways. through posture, through facial expression, even through our heart rate, whether or not this new mobility culture will actually harness that and turn that into something useful, into something like critique. Of course, through architecture school, we know critique proper, which is sitting in a room, very vulnerable, standing in front of a series of jurors and sort of crossing your fingers and hoping for the best. It's a kind of amazing environment, the jury or the pen up or the studio critique, that you know we have to work really hard to not only preserve, but to kind of think about you know, again, the medium of the critique, whether or not that changes the kinds of subjects we can critique, or you know, how constructive that experience can be.
But can these type of venues be so easily transliterated online or on these kind of device cultures? Because I know Morpholio, if you aren't familiar with it, it has like these different categories, including pinup, a jury feature, and things like this. And I'm just wondering how there's this a type of skeuomorphism, I guess that's the out of date term by now. But how would you negotiate the translation of those two phenomena?
Our attitude is just that these are all technologies. So architects have been developing technologies around their work for centuries, and the pinup could be considered an architectural technology. It's a certain, has a certain form to it, has a certain way that it works, and a sort of rule set to it. So what we're interested in is how can mobility come in and enhance that or create more opportunities for it. And I think it does have us, it's not really a skeuomorphic operation as so much really getting invested in, again, the kinds of ways we've been working for a long time and sort of rehabilitating them through the digital, rather than suggesting the digital should just completely come in and, in a sense, create a new territory.
Yes, Rafi?
Yeah, I'm not sure that we agree on the term critique or criticism, because what I think what Mark is describing is more like comments. I mean, I would ask first, I mean, it's kind of a general question, but maybe to you or to anyone else, why at all do we need criticism? What does that, why at all is that important, or what is it? What is, maybe is a critique a small version of criticism as a larger term? My understanding of criticism is the informed reading, let's say, right? Mm-hmm. It's there to expose, to reveal, to help us understand a certain work of art, a certain, whether for the good or for the bad. It exactly goes back to the point of it participates in establishing that system of values, that system of knowledge. Mm-hmm. This is where criticism in its ideal form takes part, right? It is counter to the superficial reading, right? It tells us something educated. It educates us about what we have seen. It can't just be, I like it, I don't like it, I feel like it, I don't feel like it. Now, the question is, can our current digital media on all its forms carry that role? That's the question. Can we do it in, you know, less than 200 characters, right? This is the question.
Yeah, but I do think there are other outlets. I'll let Jaime touch on that too. But I mean, like these blogs, but also new journals and outlets, kind of like Clog, like Fulcrum in the UK, if you're familiar with it, that does give designers a platform that they necessarily wouldn't have. And it's not as rarefied as, let's say, the classroom or the lecture hall. But Jaime, if you want to go ahead and push on that from your perspective.
Yeah, I think all of this is a really interesting discussion, because when I started my blog back in 2006, the comments section was a wonderful place for critique and dialogue and conversation about design. And, you know, at this point, I see bloggers, they're just turning their comments off at this point. They're not even having, it's mostly spam that's coming through at this point, or people who are just like, that's a great chair, or I really like that house, or wow, I'd like to live there. But the comments that are coming through aren't a conversation. They're essentially just a comment. But they're not even a helpful comment. It's just like a general, I like it or not. There might as well just be a thumbs up. And I think this whole Facebook culture has contributed to that, because like we were just talking about, there's so much sharing and so much information that's out there now that it seems like we're inundated with it, and we don't have time to sit there and craft a critique on a building that we might see, say, on ArchDaily. At this point, we just like it or we don't like it, and then we move on, because there's just so much coming at us on all of our apps and all of our devices and in our daily lives on screens everywhere. I think that conversation is a challenge now. And so we think that this information sharing is so great, but at the same time, I think it disconnects us from having more helpful conversations and being able to utilize, you know, all of these digital devices and platforms to encourage that conversation. So I think that's something that we need to think about, especially me and other online publications, is how can we better enable more conversation that's, you know, useful and, you know, helps progress design and architecture online. Otherwise, I think we're all just going to turn off our comments and call it a day.
I mean, I'm going to put Kyle on the spot here because you just referenced how rapid things are kind of flying by us at all times, and Clog's mantra is slowing things down. So if Kyle wants to.
Sure. This question was really about flattening of the landscape of architecture, and it's probably the guilty parties are probably to my left here. And I'd probably be sitting there if they hadn't done it themselves, but you know, a lot of websites put out a ton of information for people to view, and that's really the reason we started Clog, was because there was so much information online. A project stayed above the fold for, you know, 15 minutes. I don't know how long. Not very long. Half hour. Okay. Until it goes and gets buried by the next project. So the reason we started Clog, and I'm so glad that the Davids are responding to this now, is that there's actually a need for terrain. And not a flattening of the landscape, and not a complete democratization of the landscape, but actually to, I think this is why you see so many critics out there these days, is because, or sorry, not critics, curators, because everyone wants to be the person who's kind of culminating the ideas and organizing all these ideas that are out there, and I think those things are really important. What Clog tries to do is actually slow down this pace of information. So I don't think that a flattened landscape is actually a completely flattened landscape is a productive thing, and maybe you guys disagree with this, but and maybe we could actually have a discussion instead of.
I mean, we should open it up to you. Since you put them,
it's very.
To the task.
I mean, do you guys think that a completely flattened landscape is the way that architecture moves forward, or is it important to have a hierarchy and to have people that are actually saying that content is good instead of just a popularity contest and a matter of retweeting based on headlines?
No, for sure it isn't, and I just want to add something about Clog. There's only two media in the architecture world right now that I think that are fitting today's time, and one is Clog, the other is Mark Magazine.
ArchDaily.
Well, no, besides ArchDaily. It's hard to understand how people are consuming content right now, the dose and the amount. So going back to your question is,
flattening of landscape.
Flattening of the landscape. Yeah. Okay, actually, we think that this is very bad, because it's like there are cycles in life, and it's like the international style is happening again, and we can all acknowledge how bad it turned out to be, how bad certain aspects of the modern movement were, and those came out of this flattening of our global architecture that happened at that time, in which the world was at a crossroad and we need a global solution. Right now, thanks to technology and thanks to the vast amount of architects around the world, we can rely on not just one answer to everything. And we understand that globalization is bringing the bad aspect of globalization, that it is flattening everything, but thanks to technology, we can really think about specific local solutions with maybe a global thought, but a local application. And we understand that the future of the world is at a crossroad in terms of energy, global warming, and construction has a tremendous impact on that. And if we're able to somehow take advantage of what is being thought around the globe, so the global part, and apply it as it should be on every country in a local way, local materials, traditional ways of building, the world can be improved. So in a way, it's how can we take the global, the positive things about global, not flattening, and applying local solutions.
But I wonder also how, what kind of form this kind of content takes. I mean, it seems that the logo and global are kind of mixed on ArchDaily.
Yes.
And how you distinguish
us,
between the two.
It was the problem, because at the first, we said we want to be global. Let's do it in English. Let's go to New York. But which is the most spoken language in the world? It's not English. It's Chinese. So we were wrong about being first in English. And we have discovered that we are having a negative impact by flattening the world. So what have we had to do? Step back and start to focus. Brazil. What are the specific needs for Brazil? What are the specific needs for China? What are the specific needs for Mexico, for Chile? And that's why we have done these other ArchDailies that are a different, perhaps it's the same form as the Global ArchDaily, but the content is different. As the same project that you can see, or the same theme for discussion that you see on ArchDaily.com is very different on how it is displayed and how it's analyzed on ArchDaily Mexico, on ArchDaily Brazil, and on the Chile vertical. So at the end, the form, it changes to adapt those local needs.
Maybe Diana can talk about this more, because I think localizing this, I mean, harnessing this local potential, kind of, it calls for more investigative, a more kind of ensconced position and investigative power that Diana touched on earlier, if you want to continue on that thought.
I mean, you know, a lot of, you know, the web is able to globalize information sharing, and but what we really have to focus, even the Wall Street Journal is an international paper with all these, you know, bureaus all over the world, what is our strength is actually to focus on the local. So for you know, the example of Kellen Walled City, or for architecture's sake, the one on in Nanjing, the architecture project, we really did focus on what we have access to and making it appealing to a global audience. And I think, you know, going back to your comment about investigative stories, and taking that sort of same approach we do for politics, we do for business stories, and applying that to architecture and design, and, you know, other things too, even fashion or you know, whatever that other people are interested in, and really giving them depth by giving them context and the history. And I think that's what's probably missing in a lot of the coverage outside too. I mean, we also have a lot of, you know, houses of the day, photos of the day, where we're just giving people, you know, the beautiful pictures, the clicks that they want for lunchtime, or, you know, afternoon when there's a dull lull in their day. But then we also want to give people something deeper. And I think, you know, that's maybe where that comes in, where architecture critiques, where we can, by going deeper, we could provide a better way to talk about architecture and a better platform for critique.
You mentioned context, and David's touched on this, and Greg touched on it. But this was a major talking point for this year's Venice Biennale. You know, the problems inherent to modernization and, well, globalization, really, if you take the 100-year arc as definitive. But there's the David showed it, one of their slides was actually repurposed from the from Rem's presentation or initial unveiling of his Biennale out project, whereas you see, you know, office towers from China, Dubai, from Russia all over the world and how they look identical. And I think that's really easy to kind of, it's almost intuitive at this point because there are instant cities in China, but they're also in the UAE and also will be in Latin America and Russia too. But I think the more interesting thing is how globalization has kind of invigorated a new kind of architectural response, or kind of reinvigorated architecture as a practice, as opposed to just this one size fits all. What are these differences that, or what are these exceptional instances that ArchDaily will be covering, or that the Wall Street Journal will be covering, or that multiple publications will shed light on? I mean, the Davids or Greg, I think, just because they both referenced it explicitly in their presentations. Or Rafi, too?
Yeah, no, I'm just referring to that. I don't know who really is interested in global practices, because I'm just hearing that everyone's interested in the local, right? I mean, and that's, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong. I mean, but this kind of the global architectural practice, is that really interesting to anyone? I mean, everyone's looking for the local, right? I mean, that's the beauty of architecture. It's kind of local. I mean, cities belonging to a place. That's why we travel. So why is the, I mean, a global discussion, you know, it appears here a few times. Is that really interesting, right? Or is it a multiplicity of local discussions and we're trying to kind of tap into the local discussion? That's really what's interesting.
But I think this is what the Davids are explicitly, or saying. This is how they've kind of pivoted in light of the shared criticisms that we all have of this kind of content creation, that they are highlighting these kind of local solutions. Which, I mean, I think in terms of global practice, a lot of global practices recently have learned to adapt to a changing readership. So, you know, press releases are full of these kind of allusions to local handiwork, local ingenuity. And I think it's kind of built into these to the materials that they send out to publications like ArchDaily. So they are kind of crafting the content that we send to you guys, or they send to you guys.
Well, for sure we would say that successful global practices are the ones that have local offices. But that is not true, because there's so many global practices that don't ever set a foot on the local culture, but in physical way. But thanks to the internet, they are at least having a small sense of it and are having a way to help to understand what happens in the local site in terms of the climate, what is the local architecture, what are the solutions that the local architects are delivering to it, and in a way are having more tools to act as a global practices in this aspect. But I want to go back to what happened at a very important, and especially because of the mention of the Venice Biennale, what happened at an important crossroads of the world. The young Le Corbusier, he had a glimpse into the machine thanks to his context, a family related to the clocks. But he was a very curious person, and he knew that there was something else and that he had to travel to see it because it wasn't on the media at that time. And he had to go east. He had to approach the Parthenon. He had to measure the proportions. And all these findings that he had, he put them on a book. A book that was later distributed to some of his contemporaries who understood his point of view, who understood what was happening in East, and who were very welcoming of these ideas. Later, some of these people in Belgium, Germany, France, Switzerland, said that we have the same interest. We're also producing certain things related to it. Let's get together. And there come the SIAM, the Congress of Modern Architecture, where they had these amazing trips in the Mediterranean in a ship, but they exchanged knowledge that wasn't on a physical way before. And after every one of these SIAMs, they produced a manifesto and went back to their countries to execute this. All these early modernism things that we study, that we are still seeing as examples, and then got together again. And every time that this get-together happened, there was an iteration. All the ideas, how it worked out, let's tweak this, let's say that the city should be this, the architecture should embrace this, go back to your countries, do it, and come back in 2 more years and tell us how it went. And it was a very slow phase, and with a very reduced group of people. Then came the architectural publications that took this to a wider audience who got exposed to these local ideas that were turning global. And moving fast forward, we have the internet, in which we're sharing this knowledge so fast, and the iterations are happening not in 2 years period, they're happening perhaps one or two months, and it's producing new architecture. And in a way, thanks to the global distribution and the internet, these iterations are not being thought from the distance on, as a global response, but are being a local new answers to these iterations. So at the end, I think that thanks to the internet, since the early modern movement, what we have seen is a curve with a tremendous exponential point now. And that architecture is moving much more faster, and it's producing much more solutions, and most of them are being like very specific, and we are in a way very hopeful about this new future thanks to all this fast exchange of knowledge.
I don't know, does it need to move so fast?
I mean, that's a valid point, but
it's
I would like to hear.
How does architecture move faster itself, though?
Now, we understand that architecture, and this is a problem because architecture is very slow. To build something that is good takes time. But on the other hand, and especially at times of crisis, architecture tries to come with a very fast response. And that's the problem of architecture. At some times, we acknowledge that it should be slow, but the world really needs it to be fast. And I understand that this is posing a challenge, especially, for example, for architecture criticism. But what should we do? Should we bury it, or should we acknowledge and try to make it work?
Well, you know, I would make the difference. It needs to come fast when there is a problem and you need a solution, right? It doesn't necessarily mean it's architecture or design. I'm a bit skeptical about providing a very, very fast response, you know, to something through architecture. You know, it's not. You don't need architecture for solutions. No.
Maybe, well, design.
You need it for dreams, right? You need it for visions. You don't need it necessarily for solutions.
But that's the other thing, because what is architecture, and especially in terms of delivering a response? We, as architects, have been trained on design thinking that right now in the world is something of a high value. Apple has shown to the world that design has a tremendous value and has led to business schools to be the ones who are opening new design schools, who in a way are very like architecture schools. It's Stanford, in Chile is also a business school, so opening design schools. And it's this thing that is in our realm that needs to
move faster. But design, and design, does design extend, and kind of is architecture just a large scale design in the sense of, you know, Apple, let's say, right? Or branding or whatever, graphic.
Or the architect who designs the spoon and the city.
I mean,
Are we in that model? I mean,
I don't know. I think the ArchDaily talk was kind of very much anchored around a position of an aspirational position where everyone is. Every architect might be Steve Jobs. Or they just might be another dropout. There's no way. I mean, it's definitely skewed towards the dropout than the Steve Jobs. But beyond that, I want to go to a different question, or the last question I think that we have time for. And I think that is important when we talk about globalization and when we talk about viral voices of the internet. I think it's, when you're talking about globalizations, you have to talk about the social, economic, and political questions that come along with that. The most obvious example, and the one that was very bloggable, was Zaha Hadid speaking about construction workers in Qatar. and how architects have no responsibility for kind of building in checkpoints against those types of labor abuses. And I think the kind of the U.S., but a North American and Western European response to that was very kind of, you know, self-congratulatory almost. It was very viral. Everyone was pointing out how Zaha Hadid is a terrible person, or, you know, how Qataris, you know, employ their laborers. And it kind of makes us feel better about ourselves without actually looking at our own practices. And I think this is something that Greg talked about the architecture lobby, which was very present and vocal at the Biennale, and kind of encouraging architects to present themselves as more than just creative persons, more than just the maybe Steve Jobs, but more as the worker, the person, the 9-to-9 worker, and then kind of having them trying to think about new possibilities for, you know, and new solutions to the kind of labor problems that we have on our own turf, whether it's unpaid internship or if it's anything more serious. I mean, that is serious, but if there's anything just as serious as that. And I'm opening it up to everyone, I don't know. I think there is something that, something Zaha Hadid says, and I'll be the first to admit that, you know, a lot of bloggers wouldn't have jobs without Zaha Hadid speaking her mind. But I do think there's a kind of response to this that was widespread, and it kind of distracts from our own kind of problems that we have here. And the internet and social media and instantaneous blogging kind of exacerbates that condition. And I'm wondering if anyone else up here can talk about that or wants to talk about that.
I'll touch upon this briefly. My only thought on this is that if architecture and design has been reduced to sort of, you know, high-end, you know, non-organized labor in the sense of you execute a plan for a client and your only power is what you are billing to the client. You know, if architects have been denied that voice for a while, then the question is, if you have a voice now through the social media, what is that voice? I mean, Zaha Hadid showed off the ugliest voice. To me, my whole thought on that whole affair was, I know many architects think that. I just couldn't believe she had the bad taste to vocalize it. That was just astounding to me. So to me, the question for the profession is like, what voice you're going to articulate? Are you going to articulate a vision like the architecture lobby, where it's a notion of, you know, we must reclaim agency for ourselves? Or is it you're just going to publish, you know, your slideshow of renderings on co-design, you know, or any other XYZ site? Because if it's the latter, you're not really helping anything, and you're not really reclaiming agency for yourself. You're just producing churnalism, as they say. That to me is the challenge of that. It's not enough to have a voice. It's now you have to articulate what that voice is, and that's, you know, the danger, I think, for some people in the profession, because, you know, the unreconstructed nihilists like Zaha are going to run afoul of that.
I think there's a couple of issues here to discuss. One would be it's also the media outlet or the publication's responsibility to create a story that's good quality. So, you know, this whole journalism thing is a huge issue in our industry. But not only that, I mean, you have to be producing good quality content. You can certainly publish 6 posts a day, but you have to publish 6 excellent posts a day, not 6 junky SEO, you know, optimized posts. So I think it's really important to understand, you know, yes, you can produce 6 posts, but they should really be high quality. But I also think, you know, it's our job as media outlets to take those renderings from that young architect and say, okay, how can we create an interesting story about it? Let's talk to the architect. Why did he create this? Let's come up with some, you know, something interesting. Like, what's interesting about this? What's the reasoning behind it? Is there a story here? So I think, yes, we can certainly all take press releases and copy and paste them and call it a day. But I think it's our responsibility to take a story and make it interesting and find out what's good and how it's going to help the world, et cetera, or not publish it at all. I mean, we don't all have to buy into that whole journalism.
With that said, I'm going to say, Jaime, you've got the last word, and that was the powerful one. I'm addicted to everybody here, and hopefully this crowd is as well, and the beauty of this is, like, if there was one voice, we would die Thank God Greg Lindsay entertained us tonight. Thank God all of you are here. It was a great evening. Many voices. Special thanks to Jaime and Diane from Hong Kong and L.A.?
San Diego.
Oops, sorry. Skyping in, that was amazing. Tana and Burgess, if you're here, thank you so much. And I want to introduce the Global Dialogues chairs to talk about Global Dialogues. Dan Gallagher and Hanukkah Sim, please come up.
Thank you, Jeff. I just would like to thank all the panelists, speakers, the committee, Tana, Burgess, and Jeff, who did an amazing job three times in a row with viral voices. It's really interesting how beautifully this talk sits between the last event we had, and I recognize some of the faces, so I know you are here. The last event we had was about curated versus uncurated architectural imagery and its propagation through the internet and not through published actual physical publications. The next talk that we're having is called Global Local, which touches very nicely on what Rafi and Kyle mentioned. And Dan's going to tell you a little bit about it.
So just a brief primer, let's say. Specifically, again, we want to talk in a way through case studies, architecturally speaking, specifically about how do we as architects work or operate in kind of in a global market or a global understandings. But at the same time, with those, let's say, what are the positive aspects of that, like health, life safety issues, technologies, and in a way, sustainable strategies, but at the same time, working in culturally significant manners. So in a way, what we're going to try and do is have case studies of various practices of large, medium, and small, and how they actually work in contexts which are not necessarily those that they are, those in which they are located. In some cases, big firms, like we've been talking about, actually can have satellite offices or let's say second homes or our second home offices, but smaller offices may not. So in a way, how do these then operate within these kind of within this kind of larger global context and making positive impacts on those specific places?
Just one last line. Thanks to our sponsors, Langen, KPF, and American Standard, and our supporter, HOK, for making this event happen as a free event open to all. Share it with your friends. Come next September 15th. Thank you, everyone.